Brothers and sisters who are gathered here, I convey the goodwill from East. I thank you on behalf of India. Today, I am expected to speak something about the education in the modern age. As many of you know, the awareness of the modern age is inaugurated by the Masters of Wisdom with the various aspects that are characteristic to it. And education is one. The spiritual science is another. The ancient wisdom is a third aspect. These three aspects have been brought to light by the Masters of Wisdom during the 19th and the 20th centuries. As many of you know, towards the end of the 19th century, there was a very big spiritual revolution inaugurated by the Masters of Wisdom through their mouthpiece called Madame Helena Petrovna Blavatsky. And as the light is being carried into the present century, we discover a wonderful bridge between the ancient and the modern culture being built. Till now, beginning with Blavatsky, and yes, as the first pillar of the bridge, and Alice A. Bailey as the second pillar of the bridge. As you know, a bridge that links the two banks of a river that establishes communication across the river will have many pillars before the completion of the bridge is made. Till now, two pillars have been built. And this attempt of the Masters of Wisdom will continue until the building of the bridge is complete. But in the meanwhile, there will be a duration of one or two centuries. And the generation gap produced between two generations creates the necessity to have another bridge between the future centuries, two future centuries. So, before the completion of the present bridge of wisdom, the inauguration of the next bridge will be necessitated by the next generation of people. And it is the duty of the already existing generation who have received the communication from the previous generation and who stands on the bridge, on that portion of the bridge that is already completed. And we are there enjoying the fruits of the first portion of the bridge. It is our pious duty to see that we don't go into a process of crystallization and do not commit the same mistake which the people of the various religions have committed in the past. To that effect, the masters inaugurated many local institutes through many names. For example, the Theosophical movement, which is the mother of all the present spiritual movements, including the Arcane schools and the various other pious institutions of the present. By mentioning the Theosophical movement, I do not mean the Theosophical Society only. I mean all the spiritual movements that shared the duty of transmitting the light of the masters. For example, the Theosophical Society, the United Lodge of Theosophists, and the about 56 leading spiritual movements in the world that exist at present. And of all these movements, everyone serves its own purpose. But once again proves the truth that a movement is to transmit wisdom, and an institute, however original it may be, has no importance of its own except serving its purpose of transmitting the light. And each institution is like a page in the calendar. After serving the purpose, it fades into the background, giving place to the next and the legitimate one. And before an institution fades into the background, it begins to crystallize, and its members begin to get frozen into the winter of the year. And just as the ice blocks are different from the water in their behavior, the people who identify themselves with the various institutions begin to prove that they are different from the pioneers and the beginners of any institution. Especially in the unhealthy aspect of identifying themselves away from others. With such a phase, every spiritual institution undergoes its death in the name of a religion. And whenever a spiritual institution dies, its corpse survives for some time in the name of a religion. But at the same time, the wisdom is kept through centuries and thousands of years. Though religions and institutions come and go, just as the individuals take their birth and death every day on this earth, still, humanity survives through generations and millenniums. The masters have observed all these trends through ages and millenniums. And they found the constant need of renewing their teaching, which they once again did during the 19th and the 20th centuries. Of course, it is for us to utilize the benefit and test ourselves if we crystallize or we keep up the living awareness of the teaching. Every one of us should receive the education in its true sense. To stand before the mirror of his own conscience every morning and observe if he identifies with his own institution away from all others, or if he prefers to identify himself with the humanity. To observe whether he cares for his institution or humanity. Whether he believes that the humanity is for the institution or the institution is for the humanity. Whenever an individual realizes that his institution is for the humanity and the humanity is not for the institution, then the masters of wisdom are once again glad to see that one more individual has crossed the valley of death and stepped into the field of immortality, and that he lives with that wisdom of immortality through thousands of births and deaths. So they have their own concepts of education, and they have something to present by way of the concepts of education in the new age. You know how the Tibetan has presented his treatise about the education in the new age. I hope many of those who are present here belong to the category of the direct students of the books of the Master Tibetan. And I do hope that all those students have studied each book at least 10 times leisurely. And in that respect, I have the greatest respect for you all. And I think you might have understood the title of the book. The education in the new age, understanding the title in the light of the contents of that book. Otherwise, we are apt to misunderstand the title for a long time, just as I have done for a long time. For about 10 years, I understood the title of the book in the following way. I thought that the masters have a syllabus to present to the student of the 20th and the 21st century. But again and again, elders made me read the book with more caution and prudence. When I began to understand the meaning of the title, at the present stage, I understand it in the following way. It is not that they have a syllabus to present to the student of the 20th or 21st century, and the masters are not lacking in that much of common sense to call a century or two as the modern age, because it is a matter of simple common sense that the term modern age is a relative term and has no absolute significance. Now, we use the word to mean our age. When we invent new methods to teach children, we call our methods modern and the methods of the 19th century old, 18th century ancient, 17th century Neolithic methods, 16th century Paleolithic, 15th century no education at all. So, if the student of the next generation or the next generation were to be a legitimate child of our education, he is also forced to think in the same beastly terms. Then what is our fate of the 20th century? The student of the 21st and 22nd centuries, who has very much entered into the spirit of the Aquarian age, will be kind enough to call the 20th century people belonging to the animal age of education. But the fact is not so. We know that we are quite modern. We have modern views and we have better critical concepts than the ancients. In believing so, we are primitive. That is what the masters know, because they have seen many centuries. They lived with a continuity of the awareness of their consciousness through thousands of years. Some of you may be conscious that the masters live with a continuity of purpose through at least 5,000 years. That Master Maurya and Kutuhumi and their disciple Master Jwalkul existed 5,000 years ago with the same purpose for which they are working now. They had thousands of births and deaths to their bodies. Still, they remember themselves and the continuity of their purpose. They are not in the spell of self-mystification as to go into the investigations of the previous incarnations, into the foolish idle curiosity of who we were in the previous reincarnations, or going into peculiar phenomena like spiritism, etc., to make foolish investigations into their past lives. They are above and beyond all these glamorous ways of doing things. They are more realistic and more practical than the average so-called modern man is. They have a purpose which is more solid and more valid than what we have. They are not aimless about their living. That is why they are not nervous of their mission. By the term New Age, they mean eternity, because the term New Age was used in the previous centuries also with as much a mistaken concept as we are using it. And we, the modern, so-called modern people of the present age, are using it And the citizen of the coming centuries also is going to use it. It is but foolishly natural that everyone thinks that his age is a modern age. And those who are above and beyond this glamour are the masters of wisdom. Whenever one touches the eternal values of life, the masters call him a modern. And whenever our economic or social values touch the eternal values of living, they call our economics new era economic. And whenever our educational values touch the eternal values of existence, they call our education new era education. Only in that sense, Master Jwalkul has used the word education in the new age. He never meant the 20th century or 21st century, of which we can boast of. Sometimes people like me will think Jwalkul has written about me when he said modern age. But he has seen millions and millions of generations like me. And many thousands of times he has smiled when we thought like this. So, about the concept of real education, we find much in that book. And let us try to make an approach today. We have our own experiments being conducted in the name of education. For example, we have our own universities in the many countries, every year producing a bundle of students into the world in many valuable sciences, humanities, and arts. Many students are presented to the world in the field of physics, chemistry, medicine, engineering, and through more than 100 branches of technology which belong to the operative side of education. The universities are producing also students on the speculative side of education in the name of the students of philosophy, theology, and the various branches of economics and politics. Great thinkers who have no time to do on the practical plane, and great workers who have no time to think. And the students are coming into the world and entering into a field of competition instead of entering into an era of humanity. The mind becomes what it thinks, and a human being becomes what he thinks. And when a human being is launching his ship from the university into the universe in terms of competition, he is narrowing down his own awareness in terms of the behavior of commercial relationship, and going into that much degree of self-conditioning which no more permits him to be aware of humanity and the human values, but permits him to have only a life of commercial values. And many of us, unfortunately, are being trained into a loss of self-confidence to build a hollow temple of competition, on the altar of which there is only the idol of clay and physical matter, with a big void of hope in the sanctum sanctorum, which the human machine of behavior is trying to fill with violence. And the result is conflict, battle, and war. And we have experienced two global wars, and the blood of humanity is from one side boiling towards a third world war. Still we boast of calling our schooling by the sacred name education. So if we want to approach the professors of the various universities of the world to save us from this situation, we are totally disappointed, because they are themselves helpless. Not only having no solution, but also not conscious of the necessity of having a solution. So we are rendered helpless. Educationally and culturally, we are left as orphans on the street. And the moment we discover that we do not get the solution to the through the universities and their professors, unless we find a real source of our information, we are inclined to fill the void in ourselves with violence, to meet the battle of life through competition, and somehow to live away life instead of living life. We can't deny that many of us are living to exhaust our span as soon as possible, living a life of suffocation instead of living life with a taste to live. So we want a solution. The solution is a true concept of education. We should be able to know the real form of education into which we are to be educated first. And then we have to educate the next generation. When we are ourselves cultural and spiritual orphans on this earth, with no human relationships except commercial, and then how can we impart any education to the next generation? So we are ashamed to face our own children and grandchildren, and we try to save our face by sending them to schools, colleges and universities away. But the schools and colleges and the universities are also filled with the same type of cultural orphans like ourselves. So we want a real solution. What is real education? Is it the information we feed to the student? If it were to be true, it is more effective to feed this information to a computer than to a student, because a well-equipped computer, when properly fed, can keep the information in its memory through centuries and can reproduce with stunning accuracy. So it is not what the human machine wants. Here is a machine which is different from all the other machines. Here is a machine which you call the human being, having all the potentialities of the machines he is inventing. Besides, it contains another aspect which no machine contains. Any machine, however modern and well-equipped it may be,